This is a familiar scene in America these days. Arson is our fastest growing crime, affecting the lives and property of millions of people. No city is immune.
This is the Bronx in New York. 1.5 million people live in this borough, equal to the population of Houston or Washington or San Diego. It's the home of the New York Yankees, the Bronx Zoo, and the Grand Concourse. It has also become the arson capital of the world. Once that smoke on the horizon signified industry, progress, jobs. Now it means someone is burning down a building, a landlord for profit, a tenant for revenge, junkies, vandals. It happens 30 times a day, and the flames are the signal of a national disaster.
In the next hour, we'll see what fire is doing to the Bronx and its people. It's a report from one place in one city, but the forces at work here are no longer unique to the Bronx. The fire here is the fire next door.
The Fire Next Door. CBS Reports with Bill Moyers. This broadcast is
sponsored by Eaton Corporation, a family of technologically related businesses responding to growing needs, changing markets, and the competitive stimulus of American business. Eaton.
Handling, Eaton doesn't miss a move. Eaton. Helping change happen.
Italian 19 of Bronx Gay, box 2963, we're going to use 2 and 2. We have fire on the 5th floor in a popping 5-eye. The address is 1635 Poppin Avenue. It's a 6-story brick, non-fireproof, multiple dwelling occupied. Occupants are being removed where necessary.
Get some more line up there, baby. I think it's under the floor up there.
He's right up there,
so. Things will be coming out from under the floor. Yeah, I'm
going to run. I got a can. Take it. Get the can.
I got a closet in there. Hey, you want to change this?
Hey, Gene, Patella.
Yeah.
Make sure
they
got the roof.
Yeah.
I got it right here.
What?
Here's a shot.
Come over here.
Come on down here.
Our story begins in an apartment on Popham Avenue, a single building, 80 families. But the alarm is for all of us.
You were 15 years in the Bronx before you came to this society, right?
22 years.
22 years in the Bronx. Is this the way the Bronx started?
I would say so. It starts with fires in the vacant apartments. Before you know it, the whole wing in the building.
Then what happens? People move out?
People move out. The landlord starts to cut back on his maintenance because he's not making any profit. More and more apartments become vacant, and it becomes less profitable for the landlord. And before you know, you have a block with no one living in. It becomes a wasteland like the South Bronx.
The South Bronx. It has all the superlatives. Highest crime, poorest people, greatest unemployment, worst blight, and the world's record for arson. In just 10 years, more than 30,000 buildings have been set ablaze and abandoned here. Many of them good, solid apartment houses built to last hundreds of years. These were the homes of New York's working people, the Germans, Irish, Jews, and Italians who paused here on their way to the suburbs and to the American promise fulfilled. Then came the poverty migration. Huge numbers of blacks and Puerto Ricans arrived as business, industry, and the middle class left. Jobs were fewer and fewer. Welfare replaced work, and the poor were trapped with nowhere to go. Higher costs, lower profits, and the peculiar chemistry of poverty caused landlords to flee their buildings. The result? A fierce, malignant urban cancer where the arsonist performs the final rite.
If you were assigned to Vietnam in 1970, what would be the challenge that you face? It would be to communicate to the American people the fact that our nation is involved in a great moral struggle and a great moral dilemma. And what you were really saying is, America, take a look at it. For heaven's sakes, look what you are doing to yourself. Look at the moral dimensions of the struggle. And if that is the way you choose to go, at least acknowledge it.
Chief Tony Boza, Bronx borough commander until his maverick views cost him his job. In Harlem during the 60s, his leadership helped prevent urban rioting. Sensitive to the people of the neighborhood, he is still a tough cop.
Strangely enough, in the 60s, this society became a little bit visible, started to riot a little bit, disorders, started to hook middle-class youngsters on heroin, and boy, there was a hell to pay then, and methadone became suddenly available, funds, the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration was created, we were showered with goodies, and now we are a very efficient army of occupation, and the problem is invisible, and everybody's back to business as usual, and it's wonderful for everybody. We are creating here what the Romans did in Rome. We are creating a permanent underclass of unemployed and desperate people. They're kind of invisible. You don't see them because they drop out of they stop looking for jobs. They drop out of everything but the welfare rolls. They drink and they try to escape the reality of their daily experience. And of course, and here we live with them. But they're all dressed up and no place to go, and the society has no place for them. But now everything is being done by machines, and the second industrial revolution has sort of replaced unskilled human labor. And that's the only leg they can get up on the ladder. So they're really in trouble. And if these people weren't permanently pacified on alcohol, they'd be a lot more visible. If it weren't for the ready availability of alcohol, we'd all be in trouble. So what I would say is, America, take a look around. Look what you're doing in your ghettos. You're creating a permanent underclass of disaffected and poor, drugged on alcohol, on welfare, living in bombed out situations, an educational system that doesn't educate, a bureaucracy that doesn't respond, the sanitation doesn't clean, the police don't police. We're all here, we're all very visible, and I suppose some of us are working reasonably hard, but the fact of the matter is we're all failing, and we're just a holding operation. Look around you.
Look around, and on any day you will see a major fire set by an arsonist. There is one every hour. Bronx firemen are the busiest and best in the world. But it's a losing battle. Burning buildings are as common here as broken dreams.
Increase the pressure to the multi-volt converter by 10 pounds, okay?
You want the pressure increased, correct?
That's affirmative.
That's all.
I remember as a kid, the fire just came down a block. Everyone was excited. Everyone ran to see the fire. Now you have, you know, four or five floors of raging fire, and people will walk by and just glance and keep going, you know. It's amazing, you know. One time we took an exciting thing, now it's becoming like commonplace.
The South Bronx is a society out of control. Kids start a lot of the fires. They burn vacant buildings for the hell of it. A 9-year-old told me, "If you don't take my picture, I'll burn the building down." He meant it. A 19-year-old woman lived here with her parents and sisters. When she and her boyfriend broke up, she refused to see him again. At 4:30 in the morning, he poured gasoline under her door and struck a match. The building has been burned 11 times since. 80 families lived here. A couple who owned a candy store put their life savings into their building as a retirement investment. A rent control law left over from World War II kept a ceiling on rents, while fuel and maintenance costs soared. Losing money, they let the building decline. As tenants moved out, junkies moved in, using the abandoned apartments for shooting galleries. Parents, fearful for their children, complained. The junkies retaliated with fire. A woman and her six children lived here. $300 a month for six rooms with rats, roaches, leaky plumbing, and junkies urinating in the hall. She wanted to move to a public housing project, but a sign in her welfare office declared she would have a very long wait unless she were the victim of a fire. Burnouts get first preference. At 2 a.m., she moved her possessions to a friend's place, leaving some junk furniture behind in the apartment. Her nephew set the fire. She and her children received a little over $2,000 for new clothing and furniture and were moved to a new apartment at public expense. Arson is now a way of doing business in the South Bronx, encouraged and made profitable by well-intentioned public law. It's both bewildering and frustrating to the city's arson detectives.
You got a place to go, do you mean?
Yeah, like, you know, if you're on welfare down here, they find you somewhere else to go. You just move.
You gotta burn before you move, though.
Yeah, that way you get money for your furniture until you burnt out.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, that's why it works down here.
You think many people do that?
A few.
You can buy a large occupied apartment house in the Bronx for less than $1,000. By taking advantage of the city's 3-year tax moratorium, you can collect several thousand a month while paying no taxes, provide heat and services infrequently and only under duress, no maintenance. A few promises will keep the rents coming in until the tenants give up in disgust. Then $200 will buy you a first-class arson job. Federally subsidized fire insurance is required by law. A quick settlement with few questions puts you ahead by $70,000 or $80,000.
She set the pond in a fire because I'm a witness. I was home that day. It happened on a Tuesday.
Well, you didn't see us at the fire, actually.
How can you leave out your house in 2 minutes and come on the steps and go back in your house in 15 minutes and holler fire?
What, did you speak to her about that fire? Did you speak to her
you
about that?
You know, she told her husband, her boyfriend, who was when she come home, that the lady upstairs was looking out a window and a cigarette fell from her house into her apartment and started the fire.
Would you want to talk to us about this and testify about this, what you saw?
What I saw?
Yeah.
No.
You don't want to?
No, but I'm just saying, why not? Because I don't like to put people in trouble, especially when people put people in trouble. She burned you out of your apartment. That's right, that's what I'm saying. You should see my apartment. I'm not. Yeah, this is already. Well, what if your kid was killed? That's right, I would. Oh honey, I would have really gone. Okay, but just the moment your kid wasn't killed, you feel what the heck, why get involved? How much was done? She came, all her furniture was burned up.
But she had no furniture in the apartment.
She had, the little bit she had in there, I mean, it was already raggedy or destroyed or whatever.
Again, I ask you, you don't want to make a complaint at this time about this.
See, I should have did it at the start.
Well, you can still do it.
Listen to me.
If someone knows information as to who caused the fire, it's rare that they'll come forward with the information. Their reasoning is that they're afraid, because if they're in the area, if they're going to remain in the area, it doesn't make sense to tell the police what you know, because if that person, even if he is arrested, chances are he'll be back.
Richie, put some hands
Was garbage. Whoever lived there set fire to it, or somebody went in there and set fire to it before they left, because the girl that was living there moved out. That apartment, huh? No, that apartment was like that. I was laying down with my daughter when they came and told me the fire there. They shouldn't do shit like that. I burned up because she wants to set fire to that dumpy apartment. She's gonna pay me. If they don't do anything about it, I'm going to the precinct and I'm going to the police department, and I want them to know. Whoever lived there, I want them to know that I'm going. I want them to know that I'm going. If they don't care about the children, I care about mine. You understand? I care about mine.
What did you think the night you woke up and heard the sounds of fire next door?
I was terrified. I ran out of here. I didn't have on no clothes. I had on my nightgown, a robe. I went to the second floor. I was so mad. If I would put my hands, you know, on someone, I could have hurt them, you know. Because I figured I only been living here a year and a half. It took me a lot to do all that half. And then all of a sudden, a fire breaks out. I lose everything I have to start all over again.
And you were mad because you thought somebody had started it.
Yeah. That's right.
When I say the word fire, what do you think of?
Disaster. It's the truth. Because when there's a fire, you lose everything. If it's in your house, there's very little you could save. The firemen don't give you that much of a chance. Once something's burning, they're not gonna let you go in there and risk your life. What they try to do is get you out and make sure you're safe. I know you think about what you got and trying to save it, but they'd rather save you. So I don't want to lose what I have.
At the time of the fire, you were being arrested, you said. What time was that?
What time was the fire? What time? 9 o'clock or something?
8:30 or so.
Yeah. It was a bunch.
How old are the kids that was in the apartment? How old
were they? There was one that was around 6 months, right?
About 10 months.
What was the other one?
The other one was about 4 or 5 years old.
4 or 5 years old?
Yeah. And my two kids were
with my
sister.
No, she's only 3 years old.
She's 3 years old.
3 years old?
3 years old.
Yeah. 3 years old.
About themselves?
That was my girlfriend's kid.
And your girlfriend was here also?
No, she was down.
So the two kids were by themselves?
Yeah. Not really.
Unfortunately, what's going to happen here is there's something that happens throughout the South Bronx that people have a lack of respect for other people's property. And since nobody lives in this apartment, nobody's going to realize or stop to think that this still is somebody else's property. So it's open, you know, it's free game now. The radiators will go. They'll walk in, they'll just take the radiators because nobody lives here.
Arson detectives Jim McLaughlin and Ed Murphy.
The fire was Thursday night. Why don't you take a look at his? The fire was Thursday night, and already the sink is gone. The sink is already missing. The commode will be taken. These pipes here, fixtures off the bathtub there.
They'll even take out the bathtub if they have.
They'll even take out the bathtub if they have enough. If they have enough time. Then, of course, the radiator in this room here, this will go. And the place that they seem to work the most, the two places, are the bathrooms and the kitchens. You'll see here, all this will go. They'll pull that sink out, they'll break the pipes behind the sink, and then this will start the water. If somebody wants to steal a stove, they'll just pull it out, the gas will still be going. They can come around at night, and they know what they're doing, and they can work very fast, you know? And they won't make that much noise either. They're in and out, and they're gone, man.
I give this building a good 2 or 3 months, and it'll be vacant. You come back here in December. Probably before December, it'll be gone. It'll be vacant.
Mrs. Torres's building is not a slum tenement, but a comfortable apartment house in a healthy Bronx neighborhood. The fire is the first step toward a process of destruction that has leveled thousands of nearby acres. These buildings could be next.
Carrie Jackson has a problem and the solution.
Did you have a problem with little brothers and sisters when you were younger? Well, I'm the oldest in the family, and I say that I'm getting tired of cleaning my room when I don't even dirty it. This is my invention, and it keeps my brothers and sisters out of the room because it has a special lock on it, and it'll open just for me. You know that doorknob, that pink little doorknob there? It can see. And when he sees my sister, he locks himself tighter.
Patent not pending, but a bright future. At Eaton, we make the future our business. And ever since the first Yale lock, we've been helping change happen in the security field. Today, we have a lot of ideas about tomorrow's security, so that when Carrie has more than a little sister to worry about, maybe she won't have to worry.
But I tell you one thing, don't let anybody else hear this.
There is a stick of dynamite out there, hanging on a brand new Yale padlock, just like this one. It's made by Eaton. Actually, locks are just one of a number of consumer products and services Eaton is into. They make rubber composition grips for tennis rackets and golf clubs to give you a better grip on your game. There are auto service centers that have just about everything to take better care of your car. There's an electronic igniter for gas ranges that uses 30% less gas than a pilot light. And a dull shower head that saves hot water. What's a company that makes things like truck axles and forklift trucks doing in the consumer market? Eaton believes in making anything they think they can make better. Maybe even the best.
Davidson Avenue in the West Bronx. For years, it was a desirable community of middle-class families. While the South Bronx was dying, this was a good place to live. But decay spread quickly through here. Fire engines have come again and again. Well-constructed buildings are now abandoned and bricked up in a feeble effort to discourage vandalism. For all their drama, fires are not the story. Arson is a symptom. A symptom of a far deeper condition that persists here after the firemen have left. Society has collapsed. There remains an almost primitive system offering little protection, little safety.
When I moved over here as little as 2.5 years ago, it was quite a beautiful place and serene, so I thought, until nightfall.
You live alone?
Yes. With my dogs.
With your dogs?
3 now. I had 5. 3 were thrown off the roof.
Thrown off the roof?
I had 6. Yeah.
By whom?
Some pathetic little boys.
Threw your dogs off the roof?
Five flights, yes. Killed them.
Why don't you move?
There's people that don't want to accept me with 3 dogs. So rather than give them up, they're my friends. I stayed in that abandoned building, terrified.
You stay in that abandoned building?
Alone.
Do you have heat?
No heat, no hot water, no electricity, no facilities.
Well, how do you live, Miss Scott?
Well, I have friends across the street, too, as a matter of fact. And I go over there and cook and bring the food home. Originally, I had a hot plate. And I could heat the food when it was cold, but now I don't have that. So mostly I eat out of restaurants. And I go over to my friend's house to take a bath. One has to be social.
That's right.
His grandmother said it's not important how you look, it's how you smell.
Aren't you frightened to death of living there by yourself?
Yes, I am.
So you've been on this street 2 years and you've seen fire literally destroy apartment after apartment.
Yes. Well, this is my castle all by myself.
Do you pay any rent?
No, I don't. I'm a squatter.
A squatter?
Yes, sir.
Across the street in 1995 Davidson Avenue, several families are trying to hold their lives together in a building which, while occupied, barely clings to life. Fires, vandalism, and the lack of services have forced most people to leave. A few struggle to stay in apartments whose parquet floors and keen workmanship recall better days.
Ms. Barkley, the first thing I noticed when I came into your apartment is that your furniture's not unpacked. Why?
Oh, my goodness. Well, see, from the bed that I had had before, when I had took it up to get this in the house, I saw mice droppings all up underneath it. So I said, I'm not about, you know, to let out my other bed and the mice be running all through that because it's brand new. So I just said, I'll just leave it packaged. And as you can see, if you look around, most of my stuff is packed. So as soon as I get the place, I'm just going to move.
How long have you lived here?
About, let's see, I moved in April. I guess the following year, that's when the fire had, was in that building and burnt it out completely.
Are you afraid of this building burning?
Yes. I feel it's definitely a fire hazard.
Can you show me the apartment?
Yes.
I mean, how many rooms are there?
Well, I have three rooms. This, I guess you can say, is the living room. In the bathroom, as you can see, half of the ceiling is missing.
Do you have any trouble getting water?
Right, I have no cold water now, so the toilet doesn't flush.
And this is the bedroom.
Right. This is basically where we hang out at.
You really do live in a kind of battle zone.
Yeah.
Fire zone.
Mm-hmm. That's why I just be cool, don't deal with too many people. Just go on about my business and do what I gotta do. You know, because I'm not here to be socializing with too many people anyway. And then the type of people who live around here anyway. Like, they're part of the reason why it's like this. You know, like a lot of people always want to blame it on the landlord, this, that, and the other. Now, it's part of his fault, too. But then also, why do you have to throw garbage out the window? I can look out my window any day and see big bags going down the stairs, and, you know, out the window. So it's the people, too. It's the people who basically make it like this. And then with the landlord not keeping it up, it just gets worse and worse. Me and my sister was just talking about the garbage the other day. She was teasing me. She said, you better hurry up and get out of here before the garbage is piled up to the third floor. And then me and the woman upstairs was laughing. She was saying, yeah, you know, we got to get out of here because after a while, the garbage will be so high, the rats won't have to go through the building to get into the apartment. They'll just step right off of the garbage.
Finding out who's responsible can be difficult. The last owner sold out when their efforts to renovate and maintain the building failed. It has changed hands 6 times in 9 years. No one is sure now who owns it. Landlords refused to provide services until tenants paid rent. Tenants refused to pay rent until owners provided services. People are moving out. The building is doomed. For survivors, life in a dying building can be an overwhelming experience, especially if you're chronically ill.
Well, I put my trust in Jehovah. I'm a Jehovah Witness, and that's where I put my trust. And I'm relying on him. And I know from what the Bible says that this system's not going to last too much longer anyway, so I don't worry about my health to that extent.
How many kids do you have?
Well, I had 9 kids, but three of them are not living at home. But now it's 8 kids living here and 2 adults.
Do you get any help or any
yes,
support?
Yes, I'm on welfare.
How long have you been on welfare?
Since 19... I think it was 67.
1967?
Mm-hmm.
What about your husband? Does he provide any help or support again?
Well, he's not here, and he's very seldom here. And when he is here, he said that he don't feel like he should say anything because he's not providing for them the way he should. So he doesn't feel like he should say anything to her.
When I was here a couple days ago, you were telling me your son was arrested. Where is he now?
He's in Spartan. And I have to go down tomorrow to see about they're having his trial tomorrow.
They're having his trial tomorrow. And how old is he?
He's 15.
15. And what was he arrested for?
Having been in possession of burglar tools. And he was in a vacant apartment.
I was with him, and they said that he had ripped off this Puerto Rican dude. Okay. And they took all of us in for it. But him and Barry had a knife. Barry had a knife, and he had a stick. And they called it a dangerous weapon.
Now, he was arrested, and you were arrested?
Yeah, both of us.
Why are you out, and he's still in?
My mother said that she wanted him to stay.
Why?
Well, I thought it would teach him a lesson because this make his third time. And I thought if he stayed in there a while, you know, doing until time for his trial, that he would learn a lesson. And maybe when he come out, he'll behave himself.
Well, he's only 15 years old. I mean, won't that kind of get...
He's 16 now. He turned 16 since he's been there. He's 16.
You are leaving today.
Today off, tomorrow when I get the movie men.
Why are you leaving?
Because I couldn't stay here. They beat me up, they threw me down the stairs, and they broken my all my windows are broken.
Who did this?
You know who did it.
No. These kids?
Yeah.
These very ones?
Not them, I don't think. They were older.
Older kids?
Oh, I was cooking one night in the kitchen and the whole glass came down. It's not the first time. All my windows are broken.
While you were in the apartment?
Yeah. Every one of them.
How long have you lived here?
36 years, 37, 38.
38 years in this building?
Yeah. It was nice when I came here. Everybody was nice. Nobody was disagreeable. But you couldn't walk. I couldn't walk the stairs alone. I had to get someone to go up with me. Because one kid said he'd cut my throat if he had a knife.
Cut your throat?
Yeah, if he had a knife, yeah. That's right. He said, she has money, we kill her someday. So no, I can't stay there. I never slept for a month.
Go to my house, mate.
Because they watched me when I came in, they followed me up the stairs, and they pulled me down, they took everything I had. What can I do?
What did you say to them?
I couldn't say nothing.
But weren't you scared?
Of course I was scared. I went down to the top floor to save me from them killing me.
How old were the kids?
About, they're hanging around there listening. 15, 14, 15. No more.
You keep looking around. Are you nervous?
I can't even move. I'm so nervous.
You're afraid it could happen again?
Oh, yeah. They follow me up now, but then my girlfriend is here waiting for me. I worked at the Plaza Hotel for 46 years.
You worked at what hotel?
The Plaza Hotel.
What did you do?
I was a supervisor. They gave me a getaway watch.
A getaway watch? When did you retire?
72.
Don't take it out now. Somebody, don't show it now.
I got a beautiful gold watch and my name on it and everything at the back. And I got $100.
Is this the building here? Anybody in the alley?
The arrival of police interrupted our conversation with Mrs. Sullivan. We followed them into her building.
All right, four mileage back. They went down to the south fire escape. We gotta break this up. Dennis, it's not that one.
Dennis. Yes, Sarge, we checked that out. They broke into here.
They took it from there and they came down one of these two. So let's come up through here, huh? Check out every apartment in there, right? He's sure that's the one they went down.
All right, fellas, let's just wait a little bit for a second, okay?
So what happens to these kids then?
These kids will go to children's court. Have their mother come in. They'll probably be personally recogged. Although it's kind of early. Might get them over to court. If not, they give us a date. They bring them over with the officer who arrested them as a complainant. But they look young to me. I don't know. They look about 12, maybe, tops.
So?
What's going to happen? It's your first offense. Nothing's going to happen.
How about those other two, Dan?
They haven't made any more. They keep looking down, like looking maybe in one of the apartments or whatnot.
All right.
Keep watching.
Yes.
Were there four of them?
I got two. The other two, they must have wanted to go to candy bar.
Why aren't the kids in school?
I just asked them that, and it's, you know, the standard. They went to my family, my class went away on a trip, and they come here. There's a terrific amount of truancy in this area.
I was intrigued by what you said. You said a lot of these people work.
Well, sure they do.
You get the idea they were on welfare.
I don't get the idea. People get the idea. I don't. Sure they work. And you see, people's working, right? People are working that we just came in. That's why they're so vulnerable, because they don't stay home. Otherwise, the husband and the wife both work, right? So that leaves the apartment vulnerable. And if it isn't, they usually hit. We still can watch on another tour. Or if the wife is home, usually when they go to school, the most vulnerable times are like from 8:30 until 9:30. Big time is from 11:30 to 1. The biggest time is 2 to 3, 2 to 3:15. Because if the mother is home, she's going out to pick up the kid.
You've been at this work 11 years at least.
14.
14 years. Is there any answer?
Yeah, the answer is people have no money. That's the answer. You know, they have to steal. And the narcotics is the heavy users, and they need money. It's the same old story. It's nothing new. I'm not adding anything new. You know, just goes back to basics. People have no money and they steal. It's... Go ahead.
Down to the van.
Therefore, I'm on my way down. The officer will call you when you have to go to court, okay? But you'll be moving out today, then, right?
If the state moves come, I will. If not, then I'll be moving this week.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay, thank you very much, all right?
You won't believe this, but while we were talking to her about her previous burglary, this was going on.
Yeah, what happened is they watched her go out, evidently. And then they went right in.
Let me tell you something. She's got about $100 in her pocket. She'd been down this morning to the bank to get it out.
To get a mover, I know.
That's right.
But she couldn't get one, though. I know.
Can we do anything about that? Maybe you can.
Mrs. Sullivan?
Look. Oh, God. I can't stay here tonight. Look.
You see your cat?
No, my cat is gone. No,
we'll find your cat.
Look what they did. They broke everything here. Oh, God.
Did you have any valuables in the house?
No, I had everything wrapped, but they took them. I had lots of things. They were in here all morning. And look what they did.
You seem to have everything all packed up ready to go.
I had everything. Look, I had everything nice. Everything was beautiful this morning. And I was waiting for the moving men.
What are you going to do now?
I can't stay here tonight. I have to go someplace.
Can we call your brother?
He's sick in hospital. He has arthritis.
What is that? Ireland.
Yeah. This was in here, too. If I find my cat, I'd be all right.
Okay, we got a deal.
Yeah?
All right.
How much?
Take your furniture, huh?
How much is
this? What did you say?
100
there?
Huh?
100, right? That's good.
Oh. She's gone back there. Oh, God, she's here.
What do you got?
She won't come to me now. Nafti.
I got two of my own. Where's the door shut?
She's here. She's gone behind the car.
Okay. She was probably here all along. I tell you, they always come back. Come here, baby.
Do you want one of these nice pictures each? Oh, enough to know.
I should stop spitting at me.
Hey, that's there not nice.
No. Oh, no, stop it.
All right, she's scared.
No.
You all right?
Yeah. She
She's scared. She'll come out,
leave
though.
Leave it alone now.
Mrs. Sullivan is moving to a safer neighborhood. It, too, is in the path of the affliction that wasted Davidson Avenue. But for the moment, at least, it's a way out. The building is one step closer to death. Each vacant apartment invites more fire, more looting, and more danger for the handful of survivors. They were playing the World Series in nearby Yankee Stadium when we began filming here last October. By January, the last occupant had gone. A sound building, vandalized and abandoned, in a city of people desperate for places to live. Now, it is empty.
This kind of thing used to happen all the time. So Joe Eaton and Viggo Torbenson started building axles specially designed for trucks. That was a breakthrough. But in American business, one breakthrough is never enough. You always have competitors trying to catch up. Your customers demand more, bigger payloads, higher speeds. And you do it, or someone else will. So trucks have come a long way, a lot of it on Eaton axles. And with Eaton brakes, air conditioning, and transmissions. Today, Eaton has expanded into many other businesses, but the same principle applies. We have to keep topping our own improvements, or our competitors will. In American business, that's the way it is.
Here comes the future. To have a look at the past. In this museum, they'll see some of man's brightest ideas, inventions, machines that helped bring us to where we are today. But what about tomorrow's innovations? What new wonders will be on display in these halls in the year 2000? No one can say for sure. But there are people and companies who do more than guess about the future. One is Eaton Corporation, where the big idea is anticipating change and helping change happen. Today, Eaton is committed to the change and the innovations that will help shape tomorrow's world. His world. Tomorrow's transportation, automation, security, construction, materials handling, even tomorrow's leisure time. Look forward with Eaton, helping change happen.
The indomitable human struggle goes on here fiercely. No doubt of it, no question of it. I certainly would hate to think that anybody thought I said they were giving up hope. What I'm really saying is that society has failed the hope of the people who live here and struggle here. That's what I'm really saying. They're gonna go on struggling anyway, whether we fail or succeed.
What did I tell you this morning? I told you to put a bin over here across this way. Holy. And to put the wall tie they got right into the bin. It's the same shit.
The only thing is he doesn't want a perpendicular wall tie.
For all the devastation and decay, there is plenty of life in the Bronx. And the worst crime of all would be to write it off.
1186, 2 years ago, was an abandoned city-owned building.
That's where we are right now.
That's where we are right now. And it was 36 units. There were, at that time, in December of 1974, three squatter families. And when I came into this building, I asked them about their problems and what, you know, they were lacking. And it turns out that they were living in this building prior for 2 years without no heat and no hot water. I made a commitment then, December 1974, that I was going to put this building back together with the help of the people in the community and with the group of people that I was involved with.
Ramon Rueda is a Vietnam War resistor who came home to his South Bronx neighborhood to organize a grassroots attack on urban decay. To Ramon and his friends, unemployed people and abandoned buildings were resources to be nourished. They applied to the city for funds to redeem a blighted, gutted, and empty building and to train local workers to do the job. The bureaucracy didn't respond, so without permission, they went to work on the building anyway. Their only assets were enthusiasm and energy.
Basically, a bank uses equity as a down payment you would use towards something, and the down payment that we put here is sweat, our own sweat, our own labor, our own time towards the constructing of our apartment.
George Rodriguez is chairman of the People's Development Corporation.
Excuse me.
We'll get by you here.
There's a yard drain up in the back. We don't have a yard drain. There's three yard drains. There's a side.
What are they doing there?
They're digging out the trench for the sewer lines.
Well, you're not just trying to build a building.
Well, why don't we just come in here and ask Johnny?
Gotta be excavated either way.
What do you personally think about the sweat equity project?
The way I see it now, you're getting people from the neighborhood who've always been told they couldn't do things. They're doing it. They're working for something that belongs to them. And on top of that, they're learning a trade. So everything's being kept within the neighborhood. Sort of like a concept, I think it was in France or England, where they have your business right in the neighborhood. The people who are working there live there. And I think in this way, it will help maintain the neighborhoods because people have a piece of the action now.
Can you tell a difference?
Sure. A lot of these people here, as you can see by the sign outside, they were ex-drug offenders in trouble with the law. And so far, since we started this program, no one has gone back to his old ways.
You know, it's just one building in a large neighborhood.
Well, as what they call Chairman Mao said, was it 10,000 miles? The journey of 10,000 miles starts with the first foot. You had to start somewhere.
Thank you.
It took months to cut through the red tape, but finally the city came through with enough money for materials and training. Some are working here for a modest wage and a chance to learn a craft. Many of them will live in the building when it's finished. They have a stake in the action.
I wanted to leave a cut. Look at that. It's no good because they're going to leave a gap here. Then when I put this, it's going to be an empty space. Yeah.
Push it in.
Well, that's what you're talking about. That
is this your apartment here?
Yeah, me and my boyfriend are going to live in here.
Is that why you're taking special care with the floor?
Yes.
Is this the only floor you're doing, or are you going to do them all?
No, I do some of them. Only stuff.
How do you like working on your own place?
Yeah, it feels great. I want it perfect.
We're putting a solar energy station up on the roof to allow us to save money on the fuel cost towards the water heating and some of the space heating in the building. Now, it'll be nice because the solar energy collectors are very aesthetic. You know, they're nice. They're copper, and they have this big pane right in front of them. Panic! This is Carlos, who's in charge of the crew.
What are you doing here?
Working.
That's obvious. Well,
it's a silly question, I think so.
Maybe you could explain what's happening on the roof, Carlos.
Well, I can put a new roof in here on top of the old one. With my, with my trainees, teaching how to do a roof the better way, how to make joint, how to spray them off the tar. And so far they are not bad, and I'm glad. Because I can put them up alone. They want to learn. They said it's a mess, but they want to learn. And nobody can easy. Everything comes the hard way. Yep. You see that one? You see that one? It's one with experience in it.
The Bronx might be the most rundown urban center, but it's not the only one. And we, I think, we see the plight and the disregard towards the urban centers of this country as a national disgrace. The Bronx is number one. You know, we, more than anything else, I guess you can almost say that we're like urban pioneers. And here we are, you have this vast wilderness of decaying housing, neglect, everything else. And we've actually come in and we decided to reclaim the land, rebuild our homes. And it's very fitting that in this year of our nation's bicentennial, you know, maybe we can rekindle a small spark of some of the things that made this country great. People coming in and deciding this is where we're going to settle down and this is where we're going to make our home.
These urban pioneers have started to work on other buildings in the area. Their enthusiasm is contagious. They're beginning to turn the neighborhood around. There are other rehabilitation projects in the South Bronx. Some of the buildings are already occupied, but they are few in this vast sea of need, and the tide of devastation is rising. For every building reclaimed, hundreds are lost. The majority of people in the Bronx live in some of the best housing in America. For them, the urgent question, can the devastation be stopped? Last year, 3,500 buildings went under.
Hey, Jack, up here, get that saw up here. We're gonna have to cut the roof. Send it up with somebody right away. We gotta get the roof cut.
All right, second line, I want him in a block of fire.
Fire goes on. The Bronx burns. Like Bucharest after the earthquake, it is a disaster area. But there will be no international disaster relief. No army of volunteers will come here. Only firemen of the 19th Battalion.
These fellas didn't wait. They went right in. I was with them.
Well, we have to cut it off. We lose the whole roof.
Does it look as if it was started?
Oh, definitely. Yeah, it's a rubbish fire in a closet in a vacant apartment. No way it could have started by itself.
You live here?
No, I'm the local parish priest.
I thought so.
Yeah, right. And I belong to the parish down here, and we belong to a community corporation and neighborhood improvement association. We're trying to do everything we can to organize tenants and to help in the...
Are you making any progress?
We are making progress, and this building was really getting someplace. There was a good tenants organization in here, and we had worked up some kind of a relationship with the landlord. And then, you know, a seesaw back and forth. And then you don't know if it's because of this relationship breaking down or if there's a problem with other tenants in the building. I have a Bible group here every Thursday night. I was downstairs in the Bible group. And they talk about life things and talk about, you know, taking care of their kids and taking care of other people's kids. I mean, they're really trying. But the forces of evil in the street, the forces of evil in people who are greedy and want money and want to burn buildings for greed, you know, or for whatever.
Evil is an unusual word to hear in a situation like this.
But it's in people, you know, and it's in not just one kind of people. You know, it's in people who own things. It's in people who want to make money because they want to move. It's in all kinds of things. Or it's in delinquents, or it's in people who want to strip. We don't know, you know, but it's just that it's that evil that that seems to be like a big steamroller, and this neighborhood is getting crushed fast.
Crushed.
I would like to rub America's nose in this and say, take a look at it. If you want to reject it, go ahead. I just don't happen to think that that's the kind of a society that we live in. I think our society responds to this kind of thing. I think what we need to do, our inescapable responsibility, is to bring society's attention to it. I think America is too decent a place to really let this thing go on for very long. I really do.
Some people say American business designs things to wear out fast. Planned obsolescence. I'm not sure you get away with that in any business for long. You lay yourself wide open to the first competitor whose product holds up, and I know it won't work in the businesses we're into at Eaton. Take the axles and transmission we build for this truck. We expect them to go hundreds of thousands of miles before an overhaul, and so do our customers. And when we build the clutches for a tugboat that pushes around loads like this, they better be able to take it. Same goes for this. It's one of our log skidders. At Eaton, we're proud of the way our products hold up. But pride isn't the only reason we build them this way. We've got lots of competition. So if our products didn't last, neither would we. In American business, that's the way it is.
It's easier to report the destruction of the Bronx than to stop it. For every problem, there's a score of experts, each with a cure to contradict the others. I'm sure that's one reason we throw up our hands in despair and try to put places like this out of sight and out of mind. Past efforts to do something, including millions of dollars spent here in the 60s, haven't succeeded. Somehow our failures at home paralyze our will, and we don't approach a disaster like the death of the Bronx with the same urgency and commitment we carry to problems abroad. Americans don't accept unresolved conflicts with foreign powers as permanent and immutable. Past mistakes or failures don't keep us from trying again. So the vice president travels to Europe and Japan, the secretary of state to the Middle East and Russia, the UN ambassador to Africa. No one of comparable stature comes here. We seem willing to accept this as the natural order of things. You can come here and be depressed by the slums, fires, drugs, crime, and poverty. Or you can be impressed with the discovery that even in awful conditions, some people cherish common human values and try to build a decent life among the debris. You realize that they're the best experts on the Bronx. If we're going to save our cities, we will start with them. The economy has failed them. There are too few jobs, too little capital, too much red tape, and too little effort to understand how best to help them. All that money we spread around in the 60s never got to the root need of human beings to make their own way.
Come on, Fernando, let's go home.
Let's go, let's go.
They want order, safety, and some degree of autonomy just like everyone else. It's time to bet on them. With capital, jobs, and enough time, they might collectively create from these ruins good neighborhoods to live and grow in. After all, they have nowhere to go. Their lives are at stake. For the rest of us, it's a test of whether democratic capitalism will be made to work for the poorest among us. That, and the knowledge that unless we do act, the fires will no longer stop next door. For CBS Reports, I'm Bill Moyers.
This broadcast was sponsored by Eaton Corporation, a family of technologically related businesses responding to growing needs, changing markets, and the competitive stimulus of American business.